Hey, I'm Pablo Munoz, and today I'm going to show you how I design and texture this droid concept in Adobe Substance 3D Painter. I'm going to give you a breakdown of my layer stack and also share some tips and tricks along the way that hopefully are going to simplify your texturing workflow. All right, so here we are inside Adobe Substance 3D Painter, and this is the droid project that we're going to be looking at. So let me go ahead and bring in the rest of the UI. By the way, you can do that with the tab key. So the first thing I want to show you is in the texture set list, I have four different objects. That means I have four different texture sets. So the plastic shell is essentially everything that you see that will be plastic. If I select the polished metal, these are kind of like the, the neck and the body, or like the mouth of the droid. The details are essentially these tubes and the eyes, and the dark metal is essentially what is sort of like the structure of the droid inside. So some areas are a little bit shiny, like you see here, and other ones are a bit rough, like you see here. And that has to do with like the exposure of the metal to the elements in a way. So if I bring in all the pieces, you see that what you see of the dark metal is essentially this rougher, the rougher portion of it. And I'm going to concentrate on this one because I think it shows the idea of the layer stack. So the first tip that I want to give you is that if you want to work on a design like this droid, it is easier to organize the project by selecting different groups. So in other words, all I've done is select the meshes that are part of the plastic shell, and I put them together in the same object. So I can isolate them, and every object in this texture set is going to have that plastic. And in the same way, I can apply the same idea to the other parts. Now I'm going to go ahead and enable some of the layers so that you can see the full effect. So this droid plastic essentially gives me the basis of it. So you see it has a little bit of a bumpy surface. It has some roughness that you can sort of see here. There are areas that are rougher than others. There's some decoloration towards the edges. All of that is done with the mask. So if I open this folder right here, you see I have a bunch of simple layers like this. So right now, this is the base. If I click on bumps, it just adds those tiny bumps. Hopefully you can see, right? So it's very subtle. And when it comes to texturing, that's something very important. It's all about the subtleties in the changes that you make. So this layer right here is using a mask to add those subtle scratches. So if I go into the mask, you'll see what this is doing. So the white areas of the mask is what produces the effect. Anything black is basically where this layer is not visible. So if you go ahead and replicate this multiple times with different layers, with different noise patterns, you get to a point with something very complex that looks pretty cool. So I'm going to go ahead and enable this color correction because this is the next tip that I want to give you. So talking about the non-destructive workflow, if I open up this folder right here, what I have here is a series of effects and layers that change the color. So if I turn all of this off, you'll see that this is the base plastic. I can turn this on to add a little bit of desaturation, so it makes it a little bit whiter. Then I can turn this on and make it a bit darker, and then I can turn this and change the color. So this is the idea of the non-destructive, because I can take this color right here and I can go to the properties of that layer, which only has the color enabled, and I can change this to, let's say, a blue droid, right? And I'm gonna go ahead and turn the next one up, which is basically giving me a decoloration, an additional decoloration of that plastic towards the edges, kind of like a wear and tear. So I'm gonna go ahead and select the same color, but slightly lighter. So I'm gonna use the eyedropper and I'm gonna select a color like this. And that gives me, hopefully you can see, is like I said, it's pretty subtle. I'm gonna turn this on and off. So you can see, it is very, very subtle. Now, the next one up is just to change the hue altogether. So I'm going to click on that one. And this is called an HSL perceptive. So if you go to the asset library and type HSL, and you need to make sure that the filters are set to filters or all. Let's go ahead and show all. HSL, and let's type perceptive. There we go. So HSL perceptive. If you click drag and drop this on top of your layer stack, that brings this hue, saturation, and lightness, and that allows you to change things on the fly. So I've already done that, that's why I have here, and I can essentially take the hue, which is now a blue color, and I can go ahead and change it. So I can set it back to maybe like an orange color, I can desaturate it, I can saturate it, I can make it lighter, darker, and this is a lot of fun because of the non-destructive workflow. I'm gonna go ahead and go back to what I had, because I think I like this yellow color. Now, the next layer is the one that is going to add some damage to the plastic. So if this guy has some wear and tear, this next folder is essentially a simple metal. So I'm going to toggle off the mask and turn this on so that you can see it is pure metal. Again, because it is a folder, it allows you to have a bunch of layers with different masks that creates the entire effect. Now, you don't have to create this from scratch. You can find a metal material from the library, a smart material or anything that comes with Painter, and just drag and drop it into your model. Right? But I've created my own, and then I have this mask. So I'm going to toggle the mask on, and you see that this layer is what gives me those really interesting kind of like scratches and wear and tear of the robot. So it is not a new model, it's something, or a new droid. It's obviously something that has kind of like interacted with other objects and the environment. So this is pretty cool. Now, the next tip that I want to give you is that you can have a layer that controls the difference between, let's say, the plastic and the metal material. So if I open up my metal material, you see I have this hide control. So this is a single layer that sits on top of my entire folder, and I have the hide enabled. So this allows me to change how deeper those scratches are, or in other words, how thick the plastic is before, or like the plastic paint is before it hits the actual metal. So I'm going to go ahead and turn this on and off. Like I said, it's super subtle, but this adds another layer of realism. So if I toggle this off, you see that these scratches right here are kind of like painted on. They don't really have any depth to it, but if I turn this on, then it becomes a bit more realistic. And the cool thing about this is that because it is non-destructive, I can go to that layer, my hide control, I can go to the hide channel, and I can change this. So you see, I can really exaggerate this. If I want to, you know, make something crazy, I can push it forward. That doesn't make any sense, but you have the option, right? So I'm going to go back to what I have, which is, again, very, very subtle, -0.005. So again, all about the subtleties. All right. And finally, another really cool thing that you can use to bring this concept of this droid to life is to use more details with the normal map. So in order to show you the details, I'm going to go ahead and enable this greasy layer, or it's still greasy, and that gives me some additional wear and tear. All right. And then I also have this mini display here, and this is essentially this area here. It's pretty tiny, so there's no point talking about it. It's just a little folder where I like to organize all my different materials in folders. So we have the metallic base, we have the droid plastic, and in this case, we have the mini display and the greasiness or like dirtiness of the material. So ultimately, these have four materials combined together. Now, to create additional details with the normal map, all you have to do is select a layer at the bottom, and this could be a layer like this, a paint layer. I'm just going to create a new one here just to show you, and I'm going to give it a green color just so you know what I'm talking about. So this layer is going to be your normal map. So I'm going to type NMD, so normal map details. And in here, you can go to the magic one, you can click on add anchor point, and this is going to reference this layer. Then in the mask of the metal, remember this is the one that is giving me all the scratches, I'm going to click on the mask itself, I'm going to click on the metal edge generator, and this is basically the one that allows me to change the wear and tear level. So I can just change this, right? Let's undo that because that's obviously too crazy. But this is the layer that allows me to change that. So I'm going to go ahead and reference that normal map from this effect. So let's go ahead and scroll all the way down where it says micro details. I'm going to expand this. I'm going to make sure that micro normal is set to true. Then I'm going to scroll down even further. And in here where it says micro details, I have already referenced this layer. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on this X to remove it, and I'm going to lose some of the details. And then this micro normal section becomes available. So I'm going to click on that one, and I'm going to go to anchor points, and I'm going to select my NMD, normal map details, the one that I just created. So now this generator is referencing this layer. Let's go ahead and turn this off because we don't need it. And now in the layer that we just created, I'm going to type hard brush. There we go. I'm going to select that one. And then we already have some details in here. So I'm going to type normal. And we have a bunch of normals that come with Painter. Now, in the settings of the brush, I'm just going to scroll down, and I'm going to get rid of the alpha by clicking on this X. I'm going to scroll down a bit more, and you see it has a bunch of channels. But I'm interested only in the normal. So I'm going to toggle everything off except the normal channel. And I'm going to take this one and drag and drop it in here. So now this is the effect that I can go ahead and paint anywhere. So I'm going to go ahead and click once to add this normal. Right, so now we have the normal working, but you see that this detail doesn't have any effect of the metal, right? So there's no like wear and tear around this line. So this is what is very, very cool. So I'm gonna take another one just for fun, drop it in here. Let's do that, and then one more, drop it in there. This is just to show you, obviously this is not a great design, but these are basically normal details. So it reacts to the light, and they're purely a texture. Now, the next thing that we need to do in order to affect these normal maps with the mask of the metal is to go back to the metal here and then scroll down to where it says the micro normal, right? And this is the last step. All we have to do is tell the software to reference the specific channel. If you remember, we toggle off all the channels here except the normal. So we need to tell this layer that we want to reference that. So I'm going to go ahead and click on base color, and I'm going to choose the normal. So now that I referenced the correct channel to the correct layer, we'll see that these details have a little bit of wear and tear, right? And this is pretty cool because it has its own controller. So under the micro details, you can go ahead and increase or decrease the intensity of that curvature to remove or to add more of that wear and tear just into the details. Once this process is all set up, you can just go back to a layer like this and go ahead and choose something else. Let's drop this one here. And then when you paste it or when you draw this detail, it's not only going to be affected by the light like a normal map would, but also is going to have that wear and tear because we are currently referencing this. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and delete this because obviously that's not good. And we're back to what I had before. And hopefully these texturing tips have been helpful. I just want to show you something else before I wrap up, which is that you can create a very cool render all within Substance 3D Painter. All you need to do is once you finish with your textures, you can click on this icon right here, which is the iRay. And there you go, you will be able to create a much more realistic and accurate render with iRay. And all of this happens all within Adobe Substance 3D Painter. One thing I like to do for presentation is click on the display properties, click on clear color and select something maybe like a darker color that will present the droid better. You can also hold the shift key and right click to rotate the light around and we can create a much more dramatic lighting. But this gives you a much more, you know, accurate render, much more realistic render that is going to show the texture that you created for this droid in a much more realistic environment. So really, really powerful stuff. So that's it for this project. If you have enjoyed the breakdown, hit the like and subscribe and head over to the Adobe Substance 3D YouTube channel where you can find more of these tutorials. Happy texturing.